Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 28th November 2018. The topics we'll be seeing for prelims are these three. The first one is about RBI and the government's tussle, and RBI stressed on the need of autonomy for the central bank. Second article is about the recent launch of ISRO's hyperspectral imaging satellite, and the final one is about open market operations of RBI. The first article we'll be seeing is RBI governor stresses need for autonomy of central bank. This article was taken from the newspaper Hindu. The tussle between the central government of India and the RBI has been in news for quite some time. So this becomes an important issue both for prelims as well as for mains. The RBI governor Urjit Patel has recently submitted his report to parliamentary panel on finance. So in this report, he emphasized the importance of autonomy of RBI as an institution. The report mainly focused on two main areas. Number one was the impact of demonetization, and the second was about the status of non-performing assets, that is NPA, on major Indian banks. The other areas which was emphasized by the RBI governor was, number one is about monetary policy. We all know that monetary policy is an exclusive domain of RBI, whereas the fiscal policy is under the domain of the central government. However, it is known that this monetary policy decisions, which is taken by a committee called as Monetary Policy Committee, it consists of six members, three from RBI, and three are the representatives of Government of India. So this causes an area of friction, and in order to avoid that friction, Urjit Patel emphasized that monetary policy should be exclusive domain of Reserve Bank of India. And the second area emphasized by the governor was maintaining the critical reserves of RBI. So we all know about the Section 7 of RBI Act, which was recently in news. And there was also a committee set up recently in order to transfer the excess reserves of RBI to the central government in order to meet its physical reserves. However, here RBI governor emphasized that this reserves of Reserve Bank of India is very much critical in order to maintain the country's AAA rating. So this AAA rating is nothing but the rating given by the credit agencies, and this AAA is the highest rating, which means that there is less possibility of defaults. The third major area of concern was with respect to the Basel norms. Following this Basel norms was also one of the area of concern. According to the Basel III norms, the capital adequacy ratio must be 8%. So, however, according to government's view, following this 8% capital adequacy ratio will cause a liquidity crunch, and in order to avoid this situation, both RBI and the Government of India in its recent meeting has deferred this plan to follow Basel III norms by 1 year. And here, Urjit Patel has emphasized that Basel III norms is very much essential, and government is also committed to follow the Basel norms in the G20 forum. The RBI governor Urjit Patel also highlighted the several forms of risks that Indian economy is facing. So number one is due to the oil prices. We all know Indian economy is an oil dependent economy. About 80% of total India's oil needs are imported from the other countries. And so any fluctuation in the global oil market will definitely have very important effect on India. And the second area is the uncertainty over the minimum support prices. We all know that the Government of India in the recent budget has promised to provide farmers 1.5% hike in MSP in order to achieve its target of doubling farmers' income by the year 2022. However, this hike in minimum support prices will definitely have an impact on the government's fiscal deficit, which is an area of concern for Indian economy as a whole. The third area of risk that Indian economy is facing is the low GST collection. The amount of indirect tax collected via the new GST framework is less than expected, and this is also one of the additional source of concern for Indian government. Apart from this domestic risk, India also faces other forms of global risks. First is global risk is due to increasing geopolitical tensions, especially between US and China, and the associated trade wars. In a globalized economy, every country is interrelated, and the trade war between USA and China will definitely have a significant impact on India. Adding to this is a spillover problem from the tightening of global financial conditions, especially with respect to USA's financial reserves. Not just global risks, even the states of India, they have their own risks, which will definitely have an impact on the macro level. Many states in India like Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu has agreed to give unbudgeted farm waivers. This farm waivers will definitely have an impact on the fiscal deficit of the state, and it is to be emphasized that both states as well as the center, they come under FRBM target, that is Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management target. This target, which was brought in for the first time in the year 2003, was recently amended in the year 2016 according to suggestions of N.K. Singh Committee. Okay, according to this amendment, India needs to achieve the fiscal deficit target of 3% by 2020. And in this FRBM target, every state as well as the center also has debt to GDP target. This debt to GDP target is 40% of GDP for the central government, whereas it is 60% of GDP for the state government. Due to this, several risks that Indian economy faces, achieving this debt to GDP target becomes very difficult. So, the RBI governor emphasized that consolidation in many ways is needed in order to achieve the FRBM targets, thus maintain the physical health of the whole economy. The second article we'll be seeing is, ISRO launches new imaging satellite called as Hyperspectral Imaging Satellite on Thursday. This hyperspectral imaging satellite is basically an Earth observation satellite, which means its primary goal is to study the surface of Earth. So this satellite, which was launched by using indigenously developed Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle C-43. So this Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle places this hyperspectral imaging satellite in polar sun synchronous orbit. So this in this case, this sun synchronous orbit is at an inclination of 97 degrees. What is this polar sun synchronous orbit? So if a satellite is placed in this polar sun synchronous orbit, the satellite will always maintain the same degree of inclination and also the same degree of altitude with respect to the sun. So the satellite at any given point of time from the Earth's surface will be viewed at the same solar local time. That is, the satellite remains in the same constant position when viewed from the angle of the sun. What is the aim of sending this satellite? The aim, as I said before, is to study the surface of the Earth. And here in particular, it studies the surface of Earth in visible, near infrared and shortwave infrared regions by using the electromagnetic spectrum. So by using this electromagnetic spectrum technology, the objects in the surface of the Earth can be viewed more clearly than by using the regular methods which we are using currently, that is by using optical as well as remote sensing cameras. And another important fact about this satellite is that this satellite is the third longest low Earth mission of ISRO. So this mission, it takes place for almost 2 hours, making it the third longest mission of ISRO. So along with this hyperspectral satellite imaging satellite, almost 30 other satellites of various nations, including USA, is sent to the space by the commercial wing Antrix of ISRO. The next article we'll be seeing is RBI to pump in additional liquidity of about 40,000 crores in December. So this article was taken from the newspaper Hindu. So this operation of RBI of pumping additional liquidity into the market will be done by using a mechanism called as open market operation. So this open market operation is a monetary tool used by RBI to control the liquidity into the market. So other than this open market operations, there are other mechanisms such as repo rates, CRR, that is cash reserve ratio, SLR, that is statutory liquidity ratio. So are other monetary tools used by RBI in order to adjust the quantity of money that is into the market. And it is also to be emphasized that RBI is planning to do this open market operations for the second time in the recent past. This OMO was also done in the month of October. So what is this open market operation? So this open market operation is an activity of RBI involving both sale as well as purchase of the government securities. So if the RBI wants to infuse more liquidity into the market, then it will buy the government securities from the commercial banks, thus providing more money into the market. However, on the other hand, if it wants to control the inflation by absorbing the liquidity, it will sell its government securities and absorb more money from the market. Thus, this operation of RBI, it does it on day-to-day basis, so that it can balance the inflation in the domestic markets. So why this open market operations is important? So the main one of the main role of RBI is to maintain the liquidity in the economy, and the management of this liquidity is very much essential so that the banks of India have enough cash to lend, which will in turn contribute to the development of Indian economy. The articles we'll be seeing for mains are these four. First one is about the World Bank's ease of doing business and the business climate in India. Second article talks about the right of property and its relationship with the Forest Rights Act. And the third article is about China-Pakistan's relationship. And the final one is about the use of technology in the healthcare sector in India. The first article we'll be seeing is Improving the Business Climate. This article was taken from the newspaper Mint. We all know that the World Bank, it releases a report called as Ease of Doing Business Report. And the 2019 World Bank Ease of Doing Report, India witnessed a 23-step jump from its 100th position to the 77th position. And this jump makes India one of the very few countries to show such an improvement in very short time. And this infographics shows the areas where India has improved in the ease of doing business and also the areas where India's rank has worsened. India has showed a very significant development in the, especially in the area of getting construction permits, trading across borders, as well as starting a business. However, at the same time, though starting a business became easier in India, registering the property, paying taxes, as well as resolving insolvency became a difficult task. This shows that the firms, especially, this shows that the business firms in India, they face exit challenge. The Economic Survey of 2017 also described this exit challenge faced by the business corporations in India as Chakravyuha. So in order to continuously improve its ease of doing business, India needs to institutionalize sustainable reforms. And these sustainable reforms must cover all areas rather than just easy areas where India is already performing well. That is, India must also focus on the more difficult areas where its rank has worsened in the recent years. So we all know, as I said before, construction permits is an area where India has performed well. However, this obtaining of construction permit does not go well with other areas in the same construction sector like getting credit as well as running a business. So a business entity can perform well only when there is an organic development in all the areas. So the government must introduce reforms also in getting credit and running the business. So in order for the entrepreneurs to reach their whole potential. As I said before, construction permits is one such area that India has performed well. However, on the other hand, India has not performed well in getting credit and running the business. For the potential development of the entrepreneurs and the innovation culture in India, coherent development of construction permit as well as getting credit and running business is very much essential. So the government reforms must be prioritized in all areas rather than in particular areas. The government can achieve this coherent reform in other areas by using the same methodology that it used in the construction sector. That is, it can go by implementing a single window and online approval mechanism in order to promote the ease of doing business in other areas too. That is, significant development can be made by using technology as a tool. With India moving towards digital economy, the use of information technology can be harnessed in ease of doing business in both starting a business as well as in construction permit. However, technology alone will not solve the problem. Along with information technology, there must be capacity building. However, information technology alone will not solve the problem. Along with information technology, there needs to be capacity building. That is human resource development. The Government of India has started many schemes for human resource development such as Skill India, Startup India, Stand Up India, and also innovation projects such as Atal Innovation Mission. So these capacity building projects needs to be integrated with technology in order to achieve a sustainable ease of doing business ranking. The next article we'll be seeing is A Reinstated Right to Property Will Protect the Poor. So this article was also taken from the newspaper Mint. So this article, it emphasizes the problem of rural distress. So this rural distress is evidently visible in India with the increasing protest and the movements of by Indian farmers. Be it the farmers of Maharashtra going for a long march showing their rural distress, or be it the farmers of Tamil Nadu protesting in Delhi, This area is a high area of concern as almost 50% of Indian population is still employed in the primary sector, that is the agricultural sector. The Government of India in the year 2006, it enforced the act called as Forest Rights Act. So this Forest Rights Act, it provided the tribal community who were inherently living in the forest areas with many rights. So these rights include title rights, that is the ownership rights. It includes the use rights, that is the rights to use minor forest produce. It also includes relief and development rights in order to protect the area under their domain, and also forest management rights, which will indirectly produce the both forest and the wildlife there. However, this Forest Rights Act, which was meant to correct the historical wrongs which were cemented on the tribals from the era of the British colonization, has not really achieved its aims. The tribal communities continue to suffer from several forms of discrimination, which is evident from the recent protest in which many tribal people participated. And in this protest, one important area which was emphasized was the property rights. So let's see the constitutional validity of the property rights in India. So during the birth of Indian Constitution, right to property was a part of the fundamental rights in Article 19. However, this right to property as a fundamental rights was challenged in the very first constitutional amendment in the year 1951. Right to property was viewed as a right in support of the rich, and it was a right which increased the inequality according to the poor. So this with subsequent constitutional amendments, especially in the year 1978, via 44th constitutional amendments, this right to property was removed from the fundamental rights, and it was placed as a constitutional right in Article 300A of Indian Constitution. So what are the major areas of concern faced by the poor, especially the poor farmers? First one is, the farmers do not have much legal resources. Though the Constitution of India in the form of DPSP Article 39A, it provides free legal aid to the poor people. However, in spite of that, the poor people do not have any legal resources or any political background in order to fight the laws, as well as red tapeism existing in every level of administrative order in order to fight back for their property issues, that is land here. However, on the other hand, farmers do not have enough opportunities to move on to other fields of employment. Because of their lack of education as well as lack of awareness, they are not able to find any other formal source of employment, and thus they are forcibly forced to separate it from the property, and thus pushing them into the debt trap. So what is the way out of this problem faced by the poor farmers? We can take the state of Odisha as example. Recently, few weeks back, the Odisha state government has passed an act in order to give formal property rights to slum dwellers. So such act can be followed by other states in an inclusive way, by including both poor farmers as well as the tribal people. And apart from this, it is also to be emphasized that any land acquisition from the poor people for infrastructure development must also come along with proper compensation as well as rehabilitation to support the lives of the poor. The next article we'll be seeing is the China-Pakistan love affair in troubled waters. This article was also taken from the newspaper Mint. We all know about the increasing domination of China, not just in Indo-Pacific area, but also all throughout the world by using its One Road, One Belt project. By using this One Belt, One Road project, it plans to bring in infrastructural development in many developing countries in the continents of Asia, Africa, and also in Europe. And the country of Pakistan is one such country which is under the channel of this One Belt, One Road initiative of China. Pakistan, being a part of One Belt, One Road project, has two main concerns. One is the concern for India. However, the second concern is with respect to the nationalists in the area of Balochistan. China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, which is a part of WOBOR, passes through India's Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. So this raises security issues for India, and it also questions the India's sovereignty over the area of Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. However, on the other hand, the province of Balochistan in Pakistan, it occupies the central stage in the project of China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. This Baluchistan is a province which is very much rich in minerals, gas, as well as coal. However, in spite of being very rich in geographical resources, this Baluchistan continues to be one of the impoverished regions. This Baluchistan remains to be one of the impoverished regions of Pakistan, having high level of poverty, which has resulted in political turmoil in the area. So, because of the increasing Chinese domination in the Baluchistan area, the Baloch nationalists, they accuse Pakistan government for pursuing exploitative policies at the expense of the region without giving them due credits. So, this map shows the Baluchistan province, and this is Pakistan occupied Kashmir via which CPEC project of China passes. So, Pakistan agreed to become part of this China-Pakistan economic corridor as it is supposed to bring infrastructural development to the state. But what is the interest of China to develop this project? We all know, this project of China, it plans to link the western Xinjiang province to Gwadar port of Pakistan. We all know that this Xinjiang province is one of the troubled provinces of China. This Xinjiang province is occupied by Uyghur Muslims. So this Xinjiang province is one of the troubled areas of China. This underdeveloped area is occupied by Uyghur Muslims. This Uyghur Muslims, they are already going on anti-national protest due to lack of development in this area. Thus, by connecting the Xinjiang province to Gwadar, China plans to bring in economic development in the Xinjiang province. Second plan of China is, the Chinese policymakers also view this whole project as an alternative to the Malacca Strait. We all know Malacca is a very thin strait connecting Pacific Ocean to the Indian Ocean. Actually, this Strait of Malacca, it contributes to about 85% of the total oil trade of the world. And so in order to avoid this over-dependence on a single strait, the Chinese policymakers are viewing to develop this China-Pakistan corridor as an alternative to this Malacca dilemma. So as Pakistan sees this CPEC project as a solution to their economic crisis, they even developed a dedicated CPEC task force in order to avoid any security crisis during this project. However, in spite of creating this security force, the ability of this force continues to be weak, which is manifested in the form of increasing Baluchistan protest over the Chinese officials in Pakistan. China, via this One Belt, One Road project, it plans to bring in many port cities under its wing. One such port is Gwadar port of Pakistan, and other ports such as Hambantota port in Sri Lanka. So this port diplomacy is seen as a channel of debt trap diplomacy by many global economists. According to many economists, this debt trap diplomacy will push many developing countries into a debt situation, thus creating a difficult global environment as a whole. The final article for the day is Use of Technology in Providing Healthcare. This article was also taken from the newspaper Mint. So the government of India in the recent budget, they institutionalized a new healthcare scheme called as Ayushman Bharat. So this Ayushman Bharat scheme is the world's largest public sector health insurance program in the world. This scheme, it plans to cover almost 100 million families, and it gives 5 lakh cover per family regardless of the family size. The beneficiaries for the scheme will be chosen on the basis of socio-economic caste census of 2011. And the fund for the scheme is shared between the center and the state in the ratio of 60:40. The scheme also emphasizes the importance of the private sector in the healthcare of India. By recognizing the role of private sector in the healthcare system, it even gives them a strategic position to develop the healthcare system of India. Also aims to merge the different healthcare schemes in different states into a unified platform. For this unification of the health services, it uses technology as a tool. And this article, it emphasizes the importance of digital healthcare and development of electronic health record, which is very much essential in order to monitor the treatment of different patients as well as ensure accountability in every aspect of the treatment. And also ensure accountability in every aspect of the project using technology. So in order to go for digitalization of any scheme, the basic prerequisite is availability of data. And the primary challenge for the collection of data is coordination. So we all know that there are various stakeholders in the healthcare system in India. One of two major stakeholders are the private healthcare system and the public healthcare system. So efficient coordinated efforts in data collection is very much essential in order to effectively implement this digitalization of healthcare system. In India, on one hand, the public healthcare institution, they continue to work non-digitally even now. However, on the other hand, though the private healthcare providers, they have the digital facility, they often assume the proprietary authority over the medical data. Because of this proprietary authority, even the patients, they face difficulty to retrieve their own data. Apart from this, there are also various ethical issues. So this area brings in ethical issues such as privacy issues. So what are the proposed strategies to harness this technology in the healthcare domain? The first one is by bringing in a cross-platform medical data exchange system. Only when there is a proper mechanism to exchange data between different stakeholders in the healthcare system, the patients can be efficiently benefited from the availability of the healthcare in a timely manner. In order to do that, one can go for systemized nomenclature of medical classification. So this can be done by adopting systemized nomenclature of medical classification. So this systemized nomenclature for medical classification, it provides a coherent platform for a uniform access of data for all the stakeholders in all the states of India. However, in doing so, it needs to be kept in mind that the privacy of the patients as well as the hospitals need to be maintained. This is also emphasized by the Justice Shri Krishna Committee on Medical Data and Data Protection.